guys, welcome back to MTVTA. I'm your guys' host, Trent Manager. Welcome back all my returning patrons and all my new patrons, of course. Welcome. Really glad to have you guys here. Bringing you guys this Wednesday video today. Definitely squeezing in some time on my vacation when I can to definitely keep you guys up to date. And you guys know how fast things can move in this market cycle. So definitely wanted to hop on here today and give kind of a little overview of the Ethereum merge. EIP 1559 has been officially announced and merged. The ROPS and testnet has been a success, which has been really good. So we're going to go through quickly kind of just here. Kind of a roadmap, kind of some questions, some Q&A, also kind of just explain some kind of loose ends that I was getting some emails and questions about kind of in the upcoming weeks and in this week in general. So going over to Tim Bioki's tweet, one of the core developers for the Ethereum alt team, core devs team, released this tweet, I believe, if we're going to be correct, this was yesterday. So I kind of was just a little bit late yesterday, had a little bit of a early night last night, but really going over to the roadmap, kind of just how we're looking. We have the block sizes, the expected date, the forecast. Don't really have to worry too much about all of those, you know, forecasts and etc. But definitely, we want to pay attention to the Robson net, the RinkDB, and all the mainnet and the Coven nets. So as of right now, we do have our official date. So after the merge, we are now looking at August 4th, and I believe this kind of came shortly afterwards. Yes, here we go. 24-hour London should land about August 4th. A few clients gave a thumbs up, and we are already, but we are not sure, as no one has a serious objection yet until the upgrades. So really covering this real quick, how this is gonna affect us moving forward. We did get a little bit of a slight delay as we were supposed to have this protocol and kind of merge middle of July. So July 24th was kind of the expected date, but we did get pushed back until August 4th, possibly for, I'm gonna be honest, I think August 4th maybe be a bit too soon. I'm pushing for August 4th, but we could see maybe a week after that or 2 weeks after in August. Not sure exactly yet, but they are working overtime and they're doing a pretty good job. This stuff is not easy, of course, coming from somebody in that field as well. So big props to all the core devs over at Ethereum, really getting it done. But the EIP 1559 implementation, we also got 3198 base fee, 3529, 3541, and 35554. So really just kind of go through all of these. The 1559 is the most anticipated one that we really, you know, the public knows of, you know, for most non-developer and just, you know, people who are more in the common space of Ethereum is 1559. Base fee 3198 also kind of goes over just some more scalability issues and really dumbing things down for basic user interfaces and making things kind of more smooth on the network in terms of, you know, transferring and you know, just other smart contract integration, reduction in funds. We knew about, you know, 1559 is taking away that base fee, you know, for miners as we migrate from proof of work to proof of stake. And that has been the whole challenge around this. 1559 is not the, you know, the core of everything. You know, this is not the only update that will come, you know, kind of the blow off top type update. You know, this isn't just an update that's going to happen and then, you know, it's just done. You know, Ethereum doesn't have any more work to do. There are plenty of other things on the roadmap that need to be accomplished. And the difficulty bomb for 2021 really just kind of implements for our proof of work implementation and also having us kind of have Ethereum burned on the testnet. That goes more into 1559, but of course the difficulty bomb kind of comes later as the you know, the network keeps upgrading and things continue to scale in a friendly manner. You know, this is good. You know, of course, this is very well. I kind of knew we were going to see some delays. This is nothing that really surprised me in a sense. Nothing that really should, you know, drive you off. I really do say the biggest risk that really comes, you know, with Ethereum is the quickly changing market conditions. Oops, sorry, flying here. Market conditions and just kind of just, you know, things are still evolving. You know, no one really likes exact change, but, you know, sometimes change is, you know, not always bad. It just makes people fearful when they don't understand something that's coming. And, you know, of course, when they can't stop something that's approaching, that also is a big fearful event as well. So really heading over to Aave's price as well. We saw this in this kind of integration with Aave Pro debuts for institutional lending. So this is, we saw about a 25% jump in the past 7 days for Aave. So we knew why that was occurring just from institutional lending. And, you know, really the fundamentals behind this and why this is such a big deal is that, you know, we have Compound, we have Aave, we have all these decentralized lending platforms, you know, that are, you know, just like BlockFi, you know, that we talk about in here plenty of times. And, you know, these platforms, you know, in the DeFi sector, you know, make it possible for decentralized finance to function. You know, you get lending, borrowing, high APY staking, etc. And you know, the big thing for institutions, what we've really noticed over, you know, not only just the past couple of months, but we've noticed that Coinbase is really leading the charge, and a lot of these other exchanges, you know, are of course cooperating with still traditional finance, but in terms of institutional people coming into the space, they have no, I guess I want to say, wholesale way of these guys coming in to DeFi without, you know, having multiple wallets, or, you know, having no really instant way for institution. And, you know, definitely to touch on that, what we were talking about as well is, you know, we said, yes, we want institutional money. Yes, we want the big players here. Yes, we want all these things from them. But we did not take into effect, of course, and some of us did, of course, but some of us kind of just forgot the fact of what big money does. So big money likes to come in here and control, you know, a lot of equities and move markets, etc. But they also give us that next leg up to where we need to be in terms of a more legitimate ecosystem. So things are not always too bad. I know we have a lot of things to work on in terms of, you know, DeFi. Just had a lot of you know, back and forth, you know, sentiment talks of, you know, hey, like, is this, you know, such a good idea? You know, the whole point of blockchain is, you know, to have, you know, power to the people and anonymous and you know, permissionless and, you know, no single point of failure. And yeah, we're still keeping all those. You know, there are still things that are, you know, going to be kept, and some things that, you know, cannot be changed by institutional money. But in terms of, there are still some things on the checklist that you know, still are affected, you know, by big money right now. And that comes into, there's not a single point as to, you know, what causes this, but, you know, the big money just brings along a lot of perks, you know, a lot of perks and a lot of cons too. So I, in way of saying this, you know, that was a kind of a big concern that I was seeing, was, you know, big money stepping into DeFi and, you know, really controlling it and not making it really decentralized finance. But, you know, these guys are still people too, and, you know, they still, you know, regardless they have billions of dollars or, you know, $100, you know, these guys are still looking for the exact same outlet and kind of just making the same more legitimate space. So kind of just wanted to cover that and just, you know, make sure that was that was out there as well. You know, another tweet from Noah Goldberg. Ave Pro coming in July. For those who intended the next steps in institutional DeFi Zoom with Santi, here's the recap email I received, which is super cool. I thought this was really awesome. You know, DeFi, dear attendee, thank you for attending the Blackwoods webinar, you know, et cetera. We can go down to some of the points. Ave uses the battle-tested and extension-audited V2 smart contract system, V2 smart contract system, and adds a layer of whitelisting so that KYC participants can access the Aave Pro pool. Initial Aave liquidity pools consist of only four assets: Bitcoin, Ethereum, USDC, and Aave. Institutional demand is concrete in these assets, you know, et cetera, et cetera. You know, this is really good to see. We're seeing, you know, DeFi really take the approach. And, you know, you guys know here that, you know, Ethereum, if you are a heavy believer in Ethereum, and this is something that, you know, you do believe long term, and you do believe that it's going to benefit not only yourself, but, you know, people around the world, you're essentially longing on, you know, you are hopeful on DeFi and all the projects that Ethereum supports, in terms of decentralized finance and just NFTs, etc. Anything that holds, you know, asset value, you know, you're pretty much long on those as well. So just kind of wanted to, I know a lot of people know that already, but, you know, I try to keep the, you know, the knowledge flowing. You know, I anticipate everyone here is fairly new, and I know some of you guys are here are not new as well, but I kind of like to throw that out there just because it's a lot easier just to backtrack on questions and whatnot. So, you know, kind of a more, here, we won't go to that just now, but Goldman Sachs Ethereum's popularity could see Ethereum become dominant, a store of value. You know, we've talked about this many times. We've been talking about this for months now. You know, we've anticipated this update for quite a while. Depending how long you've been here and along the channel or just following the space in general, you know, we had seen a lot of ups and downs with the merge, and we're kind of not out of the woods just yet either. You know, we're just really waiting to see how this plays out. We haven't seen any too much, you know, black swan events in terms of, you know, things either being majorly delayed or, you know, communities not being on board with, you know, the upgrade protocols and, you know, really moving forward. You know, we haven't seen any of that just yet, really. But really going over to Lark Davis's tweets, this is kind of just a brief overview just for, I didn't want to get too super duper like nerdy technical just because I know like some of the times you guys don't even know really like half the time of what I'm talking about when I start getting into, you know, really deep protocols and somewhat. And that's something that, you know, we can definitely get into. It's just got to be a longer video. And I just wanted to keep this one nice and short today, just for the fact I'm on vacation and I don't have all my, you know, goodies and books and everything I need to, you know, make this video an in-depth video in that sense. And so really just going through, and Lark does a really good job of this, so if you guys want to, you know, follow him, give him a follow and, you know, follow his, you know, crypto Twitter updates as well. He's phenomenal. I've been watching him for quite a long time. But realistically, starting at the top here, we have the Ethereum London hard fork coming soon. This was from yesterday. It may not actually be soon. Hello, Ethereum man, Cortez, are, you know, meeting on the 9th. You know, he talked about the delays, and then, you know, goes over, by the way, kind of just getting all the myths and twists out of there. But by the way, there's no fork coin to claim. Just kind of some common questions that people had and some issues. The proposed upgrades are currently live on Ethereum's testnet. There are a total of 5 technical upgrades, including in this fork, just like we talked about in the other EIPs. EIP 3559, the difficulty bomb delayed until November, the crucial to keep miners happy until the proof of work stake merger happens. Yep, kind of like just like kind of what we talked about earlier, or I guess a couple weeks ago, we kind of talked about the mining and the issues they had there. But EIP 3198 gives EVM machine access and block base fee. EIP 3559 removes and reduces gas refunds. EIP 3541 rejects new contracts starting with 0xEF byte. So not to get too much into that, but that's just something that is usually associated with defaulty smart contracts and contracts that are not actually, you know, as true as they were written. You know, I know we talked about how smart contracts are, you know, pretty much immutable once launched, and, you know, they're transparent. But of course, if you don't know what you're reading in the smart contract, you may not catch the, you know, the bug or the glitch or something that, you know, someone had wrote there for, you know, a possible not true smart contract. We've seen that a little, not as often, but that has been a really, really big concern for us moving forward. And the biggest and most anticipated upgrade, 1.59, which will be introducing the base fee burn, and we'll be making layer 2 much more reliable. Yeah, we covered a lot of this as weeks to come. Just really wanted to come on here and really kind of just give the quick update and kind of just see where we are. But really the conclusion of where we are, where we're wrapping up, this really is a patience band game. And us moving forward, we're going to be, I think, just fine. You know, we saw a slight delay. That's okay. You know, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, not that super big a deal. You've made it this far, you know, waiting for this protocol update. So, you know, what's more than waiting, you know, 2 more weeks or 3 more weeks. And I think as we continue, DeFi will continue to grab the attention of institutional players. We know that JP Morgan is enjoyed Ethereum. We know Goldman Sachs has come out as well. You know, lots of big banks in the U.S., Banlore. I don't think that's the name of the bank, but one of the first, America's oldest bank, now is starting to process crypto transactions. We saw Visa. I didn't pull up this article, but Visa as well, having that even more interest and getting their transactions settled through the Ethereum network. I think 2021's proposal came out for how much money people spent in crypto for Visa. I believe it topped over like well over $1.5 billion, which is absolutely astronomical. We talked about PayPal as well. Ethereum processing more transactions and more liquidity volume than PayPal did their entire year in one quarter. So if this isn't raising any, you know, light bulbs or green flags, and I've got to pick up the slack a little bit, because I do try to, you know, try to put everything out on the table for you guys in the most simple implicit terms to make it as easy as I can for you guys to you know, really grasp this this technology and these assets moving forward. So other than that, guys, that's really all I had today. It's about 10:30 here. I'm gonna get planned out for tomorrow and see how things are gonna go tomorrow. I'm gonna give a test live stream later today, and if the test live stream doesn't work out well, then of course we will do we'll just do another video. That's not too big of a deal at all. So alrighty, guys, thanks so much, appreciate you chiming in, and I will hopefully see you guys on Thursday. Thanks so much, bye-bye.